shocking assassination of a president.
John F. Kennedy's murder was probably one of the most terrible moments in the history of our country.
The outrageous murder of the suspect.
Oswald's been shot.
The total obsession of a district attorney.
Who killed the president?
Oh, man.
Do I have to spell it out for you, Mr. Garrison?
Who will risk everything.
I think you care more about John Kennedy than your own family.
To find the truth.
Why was Kennedy killed?
There's a death warrant out for me, you know?
Who benefited?
The government's gonna jump all over your head, Jimbo.
Who has the power to cover it up?
Who killed JFK?
Now, we're through the looking glass here, people.
People got to know.
Y'all got to start thinking on a different level, like the CIA does.
People got to know why he was killed.
The truth is the most important value we have.
I just want to raise our children and live a normal life. I want my life back!
Kevin Costner.
Nothing is going to keep me from going ahead with my investigation of John Kennedy's murder.
In an Oliver Stone film.
I say let justice be done, though the heavens fall.
JFK.
As we move into this 50th anniversary of the Kennedy assassination, your thoughts?
Thank you, Amy, for having me back. It's nice to see you again. Hello, Peter. My thoughts. I saw the film in these last few days, and I've been able to assess it again, and I followed the cases more or less from the outside. I haven't been inside. It's amazing to me that people still deny it. As you know, I was in the infantry in Vietnam. I had a fair amount of combat experience. I saw people blown away in action. When you look, once again, at the basics of the film, the bullets, the autopsy, the forensics, the shooting path, and stay away from all the other stuff, Oswald's background, Garrison, et cetera, just follow the meat, the evidence, what you see with your own eyes in those 6 seconds. It's an amazing, it's all there. It doesn't need to be elaborated upon. You can see it with your own eyes. You see Kennedy get a hit in the throat, then you see Kennedy get a hit in the back, then you see him essentially get a hit from the front. When he gets the hit from the front, which is a fourth or the fifth or the sixth shot, he goes back into the left. That's the basic evidence. You see a man fly back because he gets hit right here. Many witnesses at Parkland, and at the autopsy in Bethesda, saw a massive exit wound to the rear of his skull, to the right side. The people at Parkland, including the young Dr. McClelland, saw his cerebellum, his brain, go out, almost falling out of the back of his skull. Later, he gets taken illegally to Bethesda, Maryland. The military—
Why illegal?
What?
You said when he was taken illegally.
He's taken immediately. Within an hour or two, he started. But it takes 4 hours to fly there. Plus, the autopsy doesn't go off until later that evening. And it's manipulated. It's the doctors at the autopsy are not in charge of the autopsy. They're naval technicians, surgeons. The military is telling them what to do. And when this whole thing emerges, what we have are weird shots of the back of his head is patched up, basically. And the shot, they're trying to justify the shot from the rear to the front. So they're saying that the shot from the back came into his back and hit Connolly. They talk about 3 bullets. One missed. The magic bullet that was devised by Arlen Specter and others devises a path that's impossible. It's 7 wounds in 2 people, in Kennedy and in Connolly. The bullet hits Kennedy
Connolly
in the back, goes out his throat, zigs to the right, hits Connolly in the left, goes down to Connolly's right wrist, and bounces back into his left knee. It's a farce, and they got away with it because it's a lot of mumbo-jumbo, and they used scientific evidence. But when people are in combat, they see things. They see people, they go with the bullet wound. It's essential. And Kennedy, it was shot right before Connolly in the back. Connolly gets shot,
Governor,
then Kennedy gets the headshot. So there's at least 5 shots here. And this is what you have to go with. Look at the Zapruder film over and over again. Even if they altered it, which—
And for young people who don't know who Zapruder was in the film.
Zapruder was a local man who shot this film that was taken by the CIA and the Secret Service. And it was altered a bit, I think. There's a lot of evidence to that effect. You get into scientific now. But the Zapruder film, even now, is the best signpost. It's the timing. It shows you how do you call it, the time frame of the assassination. And we have a scene in the movie where you see the man trying to do what Oswald did with a bolt-action Mannlicher Carcano rifle from World War II, which is a very bad weapon, Italian weapon, infantryman rifle. And you have to fire the shot through a tree at a target moving away from you. You can't do it. Two teams of FBI experts tried to do it, plus CBS, I believe, and various other organizations have tried to simulate that shooting in less than 6 seconds. It's not possible. So this was a sophisticated ambush. There had to be a shot from the front, that fence, and at least one shooter from the front. At least one.
I want to go back to a clip from your film, JFK. When former New Orleans District Attorney Jim Garrison watches a TV news report about Lee Harvey Oswald, the alleged killer, then he makes a phone call to his associate and tells him to investigate Oswald's connection to New Orleans a little bit further.
Lee Harvey Oswald.
Fine,
Ray. Instead of Marines, he apparently became fascinated by communism.
He is still believed to be a dedicated Marxist and a fanatical supporter of Fidel Castro and ultra-left-wing causes. He spent last summer in New Orleans and was arrested there in a brawl with anti-Castro Cuban exiles.
And apparently, Bob, Oswald has been passing out pro-Castro
pamphlets. Yeah, sorry to disturb you this late.
Oh, sorry, I'm watching it too.
Yeah, matter of routine, but we better get on this Oswald connection in New Orleans right away.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want you to check out his record, find any friends or associates from last summer. And let's meet with the senior assistants and investigators day after tomorrow, all right?
That'll be on Sunday.
Sunday, yeah, at 11.
All right,
thanks, Lou.
That was Kevin Costner, who played Jim Garrison, who is actually the central figure in your film. Why Jim Garrison, the DA?
Well, Jim Garrison was the only public official who brought charges in the case. He started this case. It was a very difficult thing to bring charges against the covert operations of a U.S. government, which he thought it was. You know, now that we've lived a little longer and we're older, we know about how difficult that is. We know Snowden's case, we know WikiLeaks' case, we know Manning's case. All these people have been, can't get it out. I mean, they had trouble. People disbelieve it. When Garrison believed the story, as I did, I was younger, years go by, 3 years later, Garrison calls in David Ferry. Very suspicious things happened in New Orleans, but he was suspicious, but the FBI dismissed all the witnesses he called. 3 years later, he got into the case because Senator Russell Long of Georgia told him that he didn't believe this warrant. So Garrison started to read the whole Warren Commission, and he started to see all the inconsistencies of it, and he started to call in the witnesses. He got into some hot water. The CIA watched this thing very closely. We now know that they had files on Jim. They bugged his offices. They stole the files. They had informants on his staff. It was an impossible case. Three of his witnesses died. Others just were not called. The subpoenas were denied, et cetera. He called Alan Dulles. He called several members of the CIA.
Alan
Dulles had been the head of the CIA, had been fired by Kennedy, and was the head of the Warren Commission and ran the commission.
And the Warren Commission is the one that had investigated, done the so-called independent investigation.
Yeah, you're asking me to go through the whole case here. Yeah, the Warren Commission is the Rosetta Stone of this country. It's another one of these myths that covers up. You know, look, this case is very similar. That scene you showed when Snowden was first described as a lone, fame-seeking narcissist. You find very much the similarities to the Oswald case. Oswald was identified right away on that Friday afternoon. They had the profile ready. This is a lone nut Marxist sympathizer who obviously was not only alienated but disliked Kennedy, none of which is true because he wasn't none of these things. And you can find that out by reading or looking at the movie. But the first label seems to stick. It was WMD in Iraq when you put that first story out there. And there's something about that, whether it's the Tonkin Gulf Revolution that kicks off the Vietnam War or, for that matter, the blowing up of the Maine and the Spanish Harbor. These stories spread, and that first impression stays. And it's a shame. It's like the Reichstag fire in Germany. And Oswald has been... What bothers me the most is that people who are intelligent, the New York Times, the Vanity Fair fellow, the the guy in the New Yorker, they write these long pieces, and they say essentially in the article, well, history has sort of shown us that Oswald is the consensus is that Oswald did it alone. Well, but they don't read the books by Bob Groden or Cyril Wacht or James Douglas's JFK and the Unspeakable, or they don't deal with the ballistics, which is very important because the argument, Bob Groden has done the best photographic analysis of the bullet wounds and the photography, and he can show in his last book, his most recent book is called Absolute Proof. It's coming out right now. Bob Groden has been on this for 30 years. He's the best. Talk to the people who really have studied pathology, autopsies, and photo evidence.
And Oliver Stone, why does this matter 50 years later?
Good question. What was Kennedy doing? Peter and I addressed this in a larger text in our Untold History of the United States. It's a very important president. Keep in mind, this is 13 years after the national security state starts. We are massively armed. Between 1947, Truman and Eisenhower, and 1960, we go from 1,000 nuclear weapons to 30,000 nuclear weapons. By 1960, we are supreme. We are the sole superpower, truly. We have the ability at this point, after many crises with the Soviet Union, many nuclear threats made by Eisenhower, several, five, six. John Foster Dulles believed in brinksmanship. You remember that policy? Taking things to the brink. We called it containment of communism, but really we were forcing back, rolling back. We were aggressive. We wanted a war, basically, because we knew that the Soviets would arm up after 1960. Basically, they would catch up with us eventually. We feared that. They never did, but we feared it. We knew in 1960 that in a first strike situation, we could win and we could sustain the retaliation. So we had a very hopped up Pentagon. We saw in Berlin there was an anger at Kennedy for what they called being soft on communism, which meant that he allowed the wall to be built. Remember when the Berlin Wall went up? Kennedy had a great quote. He said, "I'd rather have a wall than a war." And he was looked on as a young man, not up to Eisenhower's military status, not up to snuff. When Cuba came around, he failed to support the Bay of Pigs invasion. And then he failed to go into Laos, which was expected of him. And then when the October crisis rolled around in 62, he backed down. That was their viewpoint of it. He backed down and he said no to invading Cuba, to going in and bombing the missile sites.
It's interesting, Oliver, when we put out yesterday that you were coming on, we were just inundated with questions.
This is a very important issue.
On our Facebook page, Ronan Duggan posted this question to you. Said, would you agree that much of the history of JFK has been romanticized and he's been transformed into a sort of liberal hero? The truth is he was a horrific warmonger, said this person on Facebook.
No, Kennedy, on the contrary, you could not become president in 1960. I mean, by being soft on communism. You had to be a hardliner. It was the only way to get elected. Yeah, he went to the right of Nixon at that point. True. But he did not know the missile gap. He believed the missile gap existed that was being talked about. When he got into office, within 6 weeks, he hired Bob McNamara, an outsider from Ford, to be his defense secretary. He had McNamara go into the Pentagon and find out where we were. And he found out that it was all a myth, that in fact, we were way ahead of the Soviets on every level, and that we could have unfortunately, a first strike against the Soviet Union. He realized in that atmosphere that his generals were up to we're really gearing up for a war. Because if they didn't fight the Soviets in 1960, their thinking was that the Soviets are going to catch up. And we're going to have these crises in Berlin, Vietnam, Laos, for the rest. There'll be a war sometime in the near future, by 1970. So they're thinking about, let's do it. Let's do it now. And you remember the Dr. Strangelove movie about the whole thing about the retaliation? You remember Jack Ripper, the Sterling Hayden character? That's based on Curtis LeMay, who was the chief of staff of the Air Force, and Thomas Power, also, who was later their chief of staff. He was an Air Force general. These people wanted war. Arleigh Burke of the Navy, Lemnitzer, who was the head of the whole thing, chief of staff at the beginning. This new book, Bob Dalek, who's an establishment historian, doesn't agree with our assassination concept. He goes into detail in Camelot's Court, this new book, about how Kennedy was fighting for those years with the military on all fronts.